Gilbert Gottfried is here. As I said, I somehow wish that Gilbert could be real once in a while. We could find out things like how he feels about the death of George Carlin, what it's really like for him to, you know.
Marriage and fatherhood.
I mean, it would be really great to have a real conversation with Gilbert, but I know it'll never happen.
You've never met the real Gilbert.
No. It'll never happen. Right? It'll never happen, right?
Yeah.
Gilbert, you've built a persona, a character.
Which has catapulted me to superstar.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, maybe at this, I think you're in your 50s, I'm guessing, although you would never even be real enough to tell me your real age. This persona you built up, it hasn't catapulted you to playing stadiums.
Maybe it's time to take another tap.
Maybe you want to just become yourself.
Well, I don't want to rush it. Yeah.
When is the last time you cried for real? Like, I mean, see what I mean? Have you actually cried? Did you cry at the birth of your child?
No.
No. You didn't?
No.
That's an honest answer?
Yes.
Did you cry when you heard your wife was pregnant?
No.
Oh, I bet he cried.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, it's like crying for a whole other reason.
How are you doing? Seriously, with this whole father... And how old is your child now?
A year.
A year.
Yeah.
Do you have any paternal feelings? Do you feel any... Like, this is my little girl.
Do you hold the child? Do you coo and cuddle and sing?
I try. She pushes me away.
Does she really?
Yeah, yeah.
She senses you're uncomfortable.
Yes.
Do you like holding her at all? Do you enjoy it?
I don't know if she likes it.
But do you like it? Do you enjoy
up
it at all?
Up to a point. Yeah. Then she hits me.
How long do you last, like, holding the child or doing something like wheeling her in a carriage? Like, can you last more than 5 minutes?
Yeah, not too long.
Right. And then you hand over the baby.
Yes, yes.
Do you have help living with you?
No.
Because you're too cheap, right?
Yeah.
Gilbert's so cheap. It's unbelievable.
You'd think that he'd want the help.
He was so excited to get his free bottle of water when he came in.
Yes.
He's got two of them.
Well, he said to Gary, you think I could have two?
Oh,
well, yeah, okay.
Are you know, that thirsty?
I was even thinking about asking you today about the death of George Carlin. And I realized, like, I pulled an old interview. When Rodney Dangerfield died, Gilbert was on Current Affair.
Okay.
And they tried, because Gilbert's a comedian, they tried to ask him. And Gilbert just starts laughing at the death of Rodney Dangerfield. Listen to this interview. It's probably the greatest moment in Gilbert's career.
In August of 2004, Rodney Dangerfield went into the University of California Medical Center to have a heart valve replaced. He fell into a coma. 2 months later, he died.
Did you attend the funeral?
No.
Now, they asked you if you attended the funeral of Rodney Dangerfield, and you laughed. I mean, it was a bizarre reaction.
I couldn't even get invited to the funeral.
Is that why you were laughing?
Yeah.
That you're so unimportant? Do you have feelings about George Carlin that he died?
I remember one story. This is the last time I saw George Carlin.
All right.
I was on a plane.
Right.
And he comes over to me.
Okay, so he knew who you were.
Yeah.
All right.
And first he pays me like some big compliment. Like,
that's nice.
Oh, I'm a big fan and you're great, blah, blah, blah. And then he goes, I'm going to be sitting down now and writing something, so I can't really be bothered. So it was basically like he went out of his way to tell me to leave him alone.
Right.
It was a preemptive attack.
Yes, yes.
You weren't bothering him in the first place.
Yes.
And he,
but just the idea.
Just in case that you were. Well, he probably assumed a comedian like yourself would want to be talking to him.
That's right. To get his great wisdom.
Right.
So just the thought of me coming over to him.
Do you think he was shocked that you were in the same section as him? Is that a real come down for him or what? So you won't offer us any feelings. Like, I know when you were a young man starting out in comedy.
Yes.
There must have been someone who influenced you. You probably heard a comedy album somewhere. Or
yeah,
so.
Why are you a comedian?
Yeah, London Lee.
Was it London Lee, the poor little rich boy? Was that your influence? I liked London Lee.
Oh, yeah.
I thought he was funny. I liked him. You didn't like London Lee?
He always just sort of struck me as like...
What?
When that's when I started to wonder, do you have to be all that talented?
So London Lee, it was your inspiration because you said, gee, I don't have much talent.
Yeah.
Maybe I could be a comedian.
Exactly.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Well, that makes sense to me. You know, so many people point up like Richard Pryor, George Carlin, or Rodney Dangerfield. You had just the opposite experience. You saw somebody who was really bad at it.
Yeah.
And you said, I can be as bad as that.
Well, he made it on the Ed Sullivan Show.
I like that.
Between him and the Hudson Brothers.
So when you were starting out, was there any established comedian that encouraged you or somehow reached out to you?
No one ever
reaches out to you. Do you ever get
anybody you were inspired by?
Yeah, was there some comedian that you could point to that inspired you? Besides the funny answer, London
Yes.
Lee.
Yes.
Who would that be?
Which was very funny.
Let me see if I can get a serious answer out of you. Yes. Yeah, it was hysterical. Three people knew that. Go ahead. Yes.
Great reference.
Yeah, great reference. Do some more Arthur Godfrey.
And Irwin C. Was it Irwin C. Watson?
Professor Corey?
That was Professor Corey, yes.
And then there was Irwin C. Watson, too, wasn't
he? Yes, yes. He was the black cop.
Yeah.
Irwin C. Watson and Irwin Corey. Yes, there were a lot of Irwins back then. That was funny. Like, what about Toadie Fields? Did she inspire you?
Oh, yes. She took me under her wing.
Woody Allen or...
You know who I could see you being inspired by? Jackie Leonard. Remember you'd climb up on the piano? Well, you see, we even do an impression of
yes.
this. So there was nothing... There was no one. Light bulb that went on over your head and you said, I have to be a comedian. There was nothing like that
in your life. No, there were a lot of comics that would make me laugh.
Yeah. Who that's what I'm looking for.
Oh, Rodney Dangerfield and George Carlin.
You're like Rodney.
Yeah. once someone dies, I could say something nice about them.
Right. All right. Well, good for you. Yes. You're a fascinating individual.
How do you come up with the rules for this character, I wonder?
Yeah, now you have developed a persona that doesn't answer any questions. Like, I've asked you how old you are, you don't answer that. I ask you how it is to be a father, you get uncomfortable with that. It is a persona, because I do speak to you off the air, and you do have some...
And I really open up and cry.
You don't open up, but you have opened up at certain points when you were feeling attacked or vulnerable, like when you had your appendix out. Yes. I've seen the real Gilbert. There is a real Gilbert.
It's horrible to look at.
It's not a great guy. It's nothing that I'm attracted to, the real Gilbert, but there is a real Gilbert. So when I say to you in all earnesty,
yes,
Gilbert, you're now a father.
Yeah.
You are a bachelor, a confirmed bachelor. You were a womanizer in the sense that you had no respect for women.
Yes.
You called them filthy cunts. Now you're the father to a daughter. You are, you're the guy who would go to a party and pull on a girl's bra straps.
Yes.
Now you have a wife and a daughter. Have your opinions about women changed at all?
No, because it's always like, then you feel like, like these people who say every woman's a cunt except for your mother.
Right.
Yeah.
You feel your mother is a cunt.
Yes.
You make no exceptions.
Right. So you never said every woman's a cunt except my mother.
Yeah.
You included your mother in the cunting.
Yeah.
Yes. And you include your wife and daughter in that? You're an amazing man.
I'm teaching her that word early.
She already knows it.
Yes.
Do you curb your language around the house? Do you try not to curse in front of your young daughter?
No. What?
Are you a cursor?
Oh, he loves
you. Personal life, you walk around going, fuck shit.
Well, listen, a grown adult who weighs 87 pounds has got to act tough somewhere. Hey, fuck you. No, you show your daughter how manly you are by cursing, right?
Yes, fuck, pussy, yeah.
Now, in all seriousness, is there anything that you can say about fatherhood that has changed you? Have you softened? Is there any kind of feeling inside of you that
has
is warm and fuzzy?
Has your act been affected by this change in your life?
Oh, no.
His act hasn't been affected in 50 years.
Yeah.
He still does Arthur Godfrey impression. Are you kidding?
I still do jokes about Reagan.
Here's Tony on the phone. He claims he's from a publication called Fangoria Magazine.
Oh, okay.
He says he has cheap Gilbert stories. Examples of how Gilbert is cheap.
Yes.
Tony, what do you know about Gilbert? Yes. And tell me about how cheap he is.
Well, Gilbert is a longtime horror fan, longtime reader of Fangoria Magazine.
Ah. Well, we know that. Are you a fan of other people besides Frankenstein and Dracula, or is that just...
Oh, well, the Wolfman also.
Wolfman, too. But in Fangoria now, they deal with some of these Freddy Krueger. Are you a fan of Freddy Krueger?
Not as much as the older guys.
And in Fangoria, they do deal with the old vampires and Bela Lugosi.
Not as much as I'd like them to.
But you do enjoy reading the magazine.
Yeah.
On a regular basis.
If Famous Monsters would send me something, I'd read that.
Why do you think you're attracted to monsters? What is it about that?
I don't know, but I'm sure it's sad.
It's sad.
Should have some deep, sad,
I'm sure it's suicidal.
Gilbert, answer me as the real Gilbert. For once. Have you ever tried going to therapy?
No. I may have tried it where it was like three times.
Three times. And that was, yeah, it was too hard for you.
Yeah.
You ran away from that.
Yeah.
Yeah. You like to be closed off and, and not feeling anything. Your defense mechanisms are very, very strong.
Exactly.
All right. Tony, tell us some cheap stories about you.
Well, Gilbert, I remember the first time I met you, a friend of ours at DC Comics said, hey, this guy Gilbert wants to meet you. He wants to come to your office. And I heard it's Gilbert Gottfried. And I said, sure, that's cool. So you come up to the office, and you're wearing a white T-shirt that, well, it wasn't white because it looked like it was a Grease Monkey T-shirt, you know, that you worked at the Nike auto repair. And you had an empty backpack on your back, you know, this empty book bag, right? And so you come in, you get a look at the place, and then you tell me, then you ask me, where's the back issue department? So I point down the hall, and then you go out for about 3 hours, and you come back, and you look like Quasimodo. The backpack is stuffed with so many magazines, you're hunched over, and you can't even look up.
So Gilbert got a lot of free magazines.
Yeah, you were in our back issue department. We're still reeling from that. Do you remember
that? Okay, he got some free magazines. All right, Tony, thank you for the fascinating story.
That was an exciting story.
I got to tell you, Tony, that was worth all the trouble.
Yeah, yeah, that was pretty exciting.
That was the extent Gilbert is cheap.
I'll give you a Gilbert cheap story. Gilbert has explained that when he goes to a hotel, he cleans out the shampoos, conditioners, everything. I mean, you have a tremendous collection of shampoos.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't even wash your hair that much. It's a sickness, right? I mean, it's not like you need this stuff.
Do you hide the things so they replace them so you can get extra sets?
Absolutely.
You're not using them.
He does. He's answering in a funny way, but he does.
Yeah.
You would describe you moved a few years ago, and you said it was frightening. You had a tremendous amount of boxes of shampoos and lotions.
I had cartons of...
I mean, this is an illness, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
these
are things you don't need. You're not into lotions, and you just see it there, and it's free, and you have to have it.
Yes.
What do you think that is?
One time, a guy came over to me, this black guy, who was a fan. He worked for the Amsterdam News, big paper in Harlem. I don't even think it's that big there. It's like a handout.
Right.
And I remember when he was talking to me, I was thinking, do I want a subscription to this?
A free subscription.
Yeah. Just because he's a fan.
So what is it, an illness that you want as much as you can get?
Yes.
Do you feel you're hungry inside for something? In other words, by accumulating these things, it fills you in some way, like almost like an obesity issue.
Maybe.
I mean, I know you're not gluttonous with food, but you are very, very hungry for free things.
Yes.
Do you think that's because you're Jewish? You know, it's stereotype? Because I know many Jewish people who don't feel that way.
Yes.
So it's not a Jewish thing. It's your Gilbert thing, right?
I guess so.
Right. You're very Gilbert.
Yes.
What do you make of it, Gary? I mean, this is unusual.
Oh, you know, it's interesting because Stunner John told me a story once where he and Gilbert went out to California to do an appearance, and they were on the plane, and they were serving something that came with a tiny, one of those little tiny bottles of syrup.
Right.
And Gilbert took the bottle of syrup, the little bottle, and he took John's little bottle, too. So I wonder, like, you flew to L.A., you held onto the syrup, and then you flew it back, and then what do you do with it?
You
put it in a box.
More amazing than the story is the fact that Stuttering John thought that was the most incredible story of his life.
But it is interesting.
We were flying back.
Yeah.
They had a little bottle of maple syrup or something.
Yes.
So there was a bunch left over. There was some left over, so I just put it in my pocket.
It seems unusual, because, I mean, how much maple syrup?
When are you going to use that maple syrup?
When would you use that? Do you make pancakes at home?
Sometimes I make French toast.
You do?
Yes.
You do?
I'm quite gifted.
Yeah. And then you pull out your little airplane bottle of maple syrup.
But, I mean, you're a pretty wealthy guy. I mean, you could buy a bottle of maple syrup and not have to schlep a free maple syrup around.
I just was given a free bottle of maple syrup. I did this voiceover for when I do Cyber Chase. Yeah. It's in Toronto. So they gave me a metal tin of maple syrup, and it was like practically an international incident because you can't take it on the plane.
Right.
And I was having a woman who kept calling me saying, well, we have to know where this is from and where it's going and
exactly. Wow. Yeah. And, you know, you transported a bottle of syrup thousands of miles.
Yes.
Just to save, like, a dollar.
Yes, sir.
It's unbelievable. It's an incredible cheapness.
Yes.
Are you able to be generous with your daughter and your wife, or do you resent them costing you money?
Yes.
You do.
Yeah, yeah. She'll get the imitation maple syrup.
No, but I'm saying, are you able to buy clothing for your daughter and not be resentful? Or do you feel good about it? Or do you feel like, wow, look at these moochers. They're taking all my money.
Gilbert, when you had to buy children's furniture, right?
Oh, yeah.
That's a huge expense, and it doesn't last long.
You're going to have to get rid of it.
You know it's going to be a year and a half, but you bought it brand new, right?
Yeah.
And was that tough for you?
Of course.
Yeah.
But also, see, the thing with kids, much like with pets, and it's the same thing with, like, toys and anything you get them, it's like, they'll play with a piece of paper on the floor, but it's like, they'll invent something. Companies will invent, like, they did scientific research.
You're resentful because you know a piece of paper would satisfy your daughter much as this expensive doll.
And
then when you buy the expensive doll, she's more interested in the box.
Yeah. She'll be playing with like a paper clip on the floor. Yeah. And it's...
Well, let me tell you, you describe a fascinating rich life at home.
How did the finances get worked out? Does he give his wife an allowance or what goes on there?
I don't know. The wife doesn't have a job, right?
No.
So you're the sole earner.
Yeah, yeah.
And
Now,
do you have to give her a certain amount of cash each week so she can take care of household expenses? Or?
She pretty much deals it each week.
Really, how does she get money? I can't imagine her asking you for money.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it would be horrible to ask you for money. Does she have to go to you every week and say, honey, I need more money?
No.
How do you work that out?
I don't... She works out the finance.
No, but wait. Yeah. So she doesn't have access to your bank account.
No.
No.
To get the money to her.
How do you get the money to her? You have an envelope sent to her every month? Is that right? Your accountant handles
it? I have my secretary.
I just wonder how that works.
Yeah.
What's going on there? I mean, you're not a generous man. You know that.
No.
Right. Does she ever say to you, Gilbert, we need food?
Yeah. Why? We ate last month.
I mean, it's unbelievable. And let me tell you something. I know Gilbert. His daughter will be 17 years old, and she'll still be forced to sleep in a crib. The legs will be sticking out as she sleeps. Because he's going to say, I paid for that crib. You'll use it.
Yeah, perfectly good bed.
That's right. Well, let me tell you, you're a fascinating man.
Yes.
And I have no idea what goes on in your life. I think you have to drop the persona one time. One time.
Give me the real interview. I've had a bunch of requests for reality TV shows.
Okay.
Really?
Yeah.
I think it would be great to see you at home with your wife and child. I think it would be fascinating. And what do you say to these people who ask you to do this?
So far, no.
No.
Yeah.
Because you feel it is so bizarre.
Yeah, so I'll be Gilbert Gottfried. It's complicated.
Right.
Yeah.
Have you told your daughter that you love her? Have you ever said to her?
No, but thankfully she doesn't speak yet. So.
No, but do you ever say, oh, I love you?
No.
You would never break down and say that. Right. Why should she have that? You never had that. No one loved you,
right? Yeah, exactly.
Right. Did your mother ever say, I love you, Gilbert?
No.
No.
Did
your father, did you have a father? I don't even know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Did he ever say, I love you?
Now, here's something that...
Gilbert, did your father ever say, I love you?
No.
Does he have any, you know, like, I want to be a different parent than my parents? Are you going to be exactly the same?
Yeah, like, I'll be like Danny Thomas. Yes.
Now, he's going to be the same.
Yeah, exactly the same.
You never mentioned your father.
Yes.
Never. Is he still alive?
Oh, no.
No. And what, he died of embarrassment?
Yes, exactly.
He said,
he left the country.
Did he leave you at an early age?
Yes.
Is that what happened? Did he divorce your mother at an early age? What happened? Did he rape you? There must have been...
No such luck.
You never once, even off the air, have mentioned a father.
Yes, yes.
And no one knows what happened.
He never molested me.
Did your father pay attention to you?
He didn't pay attention in any way.
Well, would you pay attention to Gilbert? No, seriously, do you feel unloved?
All the time.
You do?
Yes.
Constantly?
Yes.
Do you believe your wife loves you?
Perhaps.
You do think she loves you?
I feel like I'm on a game show.
Do you think your wife loves you?
Is this something I find in my house?
Do you think your wife loves you, or are you just a big fat paycheck to her?
I could be, yeah.
You don't know for sure. You can't tell what love is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you in love with your wife?
Yeah, because,
yes?
Oh, I don't know. Because I once heard that with cats...
Yeah.
They look at you as a can opener with legs.
Well, that's true.
That's what someone described it.
So you think your wife looks at you as like a can opener with legs?
Yes.
Right. Now, you never mentioned a father. You even get uncomfortable as I bring it up now, don't you? Yes.
Yeah.
What happened there? When was the last time you saw your father? How old were you? When is the last time you saw your father?
When he went off to join the Merchant Marines.
And then he never returned.
Yes.
Was your father a military man?
No, I wish.
Yeah.
That would have been a good one.
He was a coward, like you said. You have
he actually was in the Army.
He
yeah,
was?
Yeah.
I didn't think any Gottfrieds had ever served.
Yes.
What is your best memory with your father?
Let's see. Watching him in concert.
Your father was a musician?
I'm just saying.
Did you ever have any moments with your father?
I'm sure I did. Yeah. Yeah.
How old were you when you last saw your father? I'm serious. It strikes me as a tragedy.
Oh, yes.
Did he die early? Did he die young?
Yeah, about 12:30.
No, really? Come on. What happened?
That
Tell
was
me.
A good pun.
Where is your dad? And what happened to him? And what was your relationship like with him? Your father served in the German army or the American army? He was a Nazi.
He was a capo in the camps.
Answer me once for real. I'm trying.
He would turn in the Jews who were planning to escape.
Did your father was a self-hating, self-loathing Jew?
Yes.
Much like yourself? If the Nazis were around now, you would turn in Jews.
Yes.
Because you're good at spotting them.
Yeah, with no question about it.
You would say to the Nazis, look, I don't want to die. I will turn in my fellow Jews.
You go up to them and say, look, these guys are no good at picking out Jews. Right. I can pick out Jews.
Yes.
And if there was a prophet and I turn in three times as many Jews.
So you identify with traitors of
yes.
your own race.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. All right. That's fair enough. That's an honest answer. Gilbert, honestly, can you tell me something? Like, were you a young boy and your dad left home? Is that what happened? I can't tell.
God.
You see what I mean?
How yes. old were you when your father died?
This is painful.
Oh, it was years ago.
How many years? Were you a little boy?
No, I wasn't little.
But for some reason, I get the feeling he might have left the family. Is that
you
correct?
Think he didn't even die.
You had no male role model. Is that why you're an awkward kind of guy? You don't have a male role model? No men ever embraced you or put... Did your father ever put his arm around you
did
and say...
Did men ever embrace me? Yes.
Men
that,
did embrace
you. That helps your life when men
were you molested
you.
As a child? Is that what happened? When your father died, did you say the Kaddish for him?
No.
Yes, you did.
Remember no.
What did it sound like?
Yeah, okay. I don't usually like to talk about this, but okay.
All right, go ahead. Bobby was in a dry eye.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm crying now.
Right. Do you know, before I saw I think it was on the internet, they had a Jerry Lewis, an early Jerry Lewis jazz singer.
Really?
And it's where Jerry Lewis does sings at the end. Well, like in the Al Jolson one, it's like really sad that he's seeing the Jewish and it's like the father's dying. With him and with Jerry Lewis, and now it's no longer blackface because that would be offensive. So he's in a clown face.
All right.
He's a clown. And his father, the rabbi, is offended. And when he's singing the big sad song at the end in Yiddish, it's like that typical Jerry Lewis of Yishkadei Machaloi Achnejivai.
Is he in a clown uniform?
It's very scary to watch.
Now, your daughter's name is Lily.
Yes.
Did you name her after anyone from the Munsters, Lily? Is Lily named after one of your relatives?
Yes.
Or?
Yes. If I have another daughter, she'll be Marilyn.
So it'll be Lily, Marilyn, and then a son named Eddie.
Yes, and Herman.
So you want to name your kids after
and
all
another
the
son named Grandpa.
I respect that. All right, here's what I'm going to do with you, Gilbert. First of all, I'm going to remind our audience why you're here. See Gilbert Gottfried July 10th at 8 p.m. at Caroline's on Broadway in Manhattan. That's going to be a big show for Gilbert and really a lot of new material, I'm sure. You cannot do the same stuff over and over again. For tickets, you go to carolines.com. Will you talk about your father if the people go to Carolines?
Yes, yes.
Well, you know, I was thinking, you know, everybody was talking about George Carlin and how prolific he was and a new hour every year. Gilbert, I mean...
You
haven't come up with a new hour yet.
No, but I'm switching around the old stuff.
You've got to come up with a new hour. Come on. In honor of George Carlin, you could do it. Now you have all new experiences.
That's right. You have a whole new world to talk about.
Now, when you sit in your apartment all day, there are other people in there.
They asked me to comment on George Carlin's some radio thing, but I passed on it because I remember it's like with me, when they ask me, it's like they're always, they want it on tape in case they can't get anyone better.
Right.
Yeah. You don't want to waste your time.
Yeah.
You didn't really know George Carlin.
Yeah, like I met him a handful of times.
Right, I understand. Well, let me
tell
you.
Do you have any bad stories? We were saying the other day that everybody had nothing but nice things to say.
Well, Gilbert's was pretty bad. Gilbert's was pretty bad. George Carlin came over and said, don't bother me.
Yeah, that's it.
See Gilbert Gottfried July 10th at 8 p.m. at Caroline's on Broadway, Manhattan. For tickets, go to carolines.com. And to purchase Gilbert's comedy DVD, Dirty Jokes, go to gilbertgottfried.com. Okay, gilbertgottfried.com. There's a lot going on there now.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, everyone's excited about
it. It's more professional than ever.
Yeah. Have you ever seen it? You're on the internet, though, you say.
Yes, there's so many bells and whistles on it.
You like the
internet. I thought he was blogging now.
Yeah.
Are you blogging still?
Sometimes.
Yeah, I have to read that.
For a while, I was just putting in knock-knock jokes. That's pretty much it.
Right. Okay, let me take a break.
Okay.
Come back, we'll do the news. Maybe you'll add something to it. Possibly not. No one cares. No pressure. No pressure.
Quite possibly nothing
right.
witty.
We'll be back right after these words.
The Howard Stern Show.
All right. Our guest is Gilbert Gottfried. Robin, it's time for news. We're going to bring in Steve Langford, who has a big penis. Steve, come on in and tell us about what's going on.
Steve Langford has a huge penis.
So he says. All right, Steve. Steve, you got to turn on your microphone if you're going to be on this show. Go ahead. All right.
Just some of the stories we're working on in the Howard 100 newsroom. What happened to Eric the Midget Knight at Arco Arena in Sacramento? A promotion labeled Meet Eric the Actor appeared to have been scheduled for July 10th. When the Monarchs meet the L.A. Sparks of the WNBA. Here's what the special offer included. Exclusive pregame autograph session and meet and greet with Eric the Actor.
Right.
Plus, the first 100 fans would get a special limited edition Eric the Actor t-shirt. But now, sadly, it seems Eric the Actor night has been postponed or canceled, possibly because of a complete and total lack of interest on the part of the public.
Eric, is that true?
Oh, it's been pushed back. You know what, Linkford? Stay the fuck out of my business, you piece of shit.
What do you mean,
what
Eric?
You don't want
any attention from the Steve Langford and the Howard 100 News Department?
Not from that piece of shit or Shirley. If you're going to do a news report, Lisa G or Ralph Howard, leave those two fuckers out of it.
Well, Steve, what is this animosity coming from Eric the Actor? I mean, what is going on? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
You know, people get upset about media coverage sometimes, and, you know.
I certainly
a
relate.
Fucking one-sided shit sack of shit. That's the problem with him.
You don't like his sources, huh?
Well, Eric, is it true that your special night was canceled because of low attendance?
Maybe, yes, it is.
Well, what do you have, Steve, what are you holding up there?
This is the actual offer, which appears to be dead.
Right. Well, why would you object to him covering that, Eric? Are you embarrassed?
No, I just cannot stand that.
I heard there wasn't enough crowd control.
Send the fuck back up to Canada.
Well, Eric, you know if you're going to call into this show, the Howard 100 News team is going to take an interest in you. You
it's
know that.
It's fine if Lisa G or Ralph Howard does it. Not that sack of shit or not Shuley.
What is wrong with Steve and Shuley?
Shuley is a backstabbing idiot, and Langford is a one-sided sack of shit.
Oh. Just wanted to make sure I understood.
Why? I mean, I'm not hearing why Steve Langford's a sack of shit.
Because he gets one side of the fucking story, and that's it.
What's your side of the story?
Well, it's nothing on this one, but the other one earlier this year. Plus, he fucking fully fabricated the whole thing with Diana DeGarmo. That was
nonsense.
Complete fabrication.
Nonsense.
Shut the fuck up.
Canada. this thing. What story did you supposedly get wrong?
You know, I don't... Well, no. First of all, we didn't get the story wrong. But, God,
what about
so
Diana DeGarmo was fabricated, Eric?
Well, geez. I guess since I got to spend time with her and her mom, that they don't have any fucking problem with me like this sack of shit says they do.
All right, well... All right, I don't know where this is at, but Eric, thank you for clearing that up. All right. Thank you. That's Eric, the actor.
Yes.
Eric, the acting midget. All right, anything else, Steve?
Also today, Sam Simon remembers George Carlin. The two teamed up in the mid-90s on the George Carlin Show on Fox. Sam telling Howard 100 News, working with Carlin was one of the pleasures of his life, calling the comedic giant the funniest, nicest, most decent guy. But Howard 100 News in the awkward position of pointing out that George Carlin on his website says of his experience on the show with Sam Simon, quote, lesson learned. Always check mental health of creative partner beforehand. Love the actors, love the crew, had a great time, couldn't wait to get the F out of there. Sam Simon says he wasn't aware of that posting, but says he regrets that the George Carlin Show ended up being a bitter experience for Carlin. Sam Simon saying he loves Carlin and doesn't care what he said on his website.
Quack, quack. Anything else?
That was like that bad show. Where he was like a cab driver.
Right, yeah. Well, Sam was the executive on that?
Yeah. And they tried to get around it by having him say dirty words but bleeping it. Like, that was going to work.
Yeah.
That was...
Bad idea?
Yeah.
All right. Anything else?
And in today's edition of Rip Off the Stern Show, the BBC debuting a new reality show called Snog, Marry, Avoid, a title sounding a lot like F, Marry, Kill, a show that features doing makeovers on women and then getting random men to render their verdicts.
All right, there you go.
Stern News, you know, to the Howard 100 News, tip line 877-33-SERIES, choose channel 100 or email us at howard100news@serious-radio.com.
All right, Steve, thank you. I'm going to go right over to John Hine, who hosts a wrap-up show every day at 11 o'clock. John, what do you have for us today at 11?
Well, Howard, Gary let you know Artie wasn't coming in, and naturally the speculation started to fly about what's going on in Artie's life.
Yeah, you haven't heard anything, Gilbert, have you?
Yeah, we're so close.
Yeah, you talk to him once in a while when you're seeking advice for DVD.
Well, you see, when you have a DVD, the important thing is you have a collection of stuff, the stuff that works. The stuff that doesn't work, you could edit out.
This is what Artie told you?
Yeah. And the strong stuff you should go with. And then you distribute it. You name a certain price, and like for instance, if one is $10, two would be $20. And so that's what you do. You pick out the best parts of the show.
So Artie really knows how to make a DVD.
Yes.
Were you glad you consulted him?
Yeah, it was.
It helped you? All right. What else, John?
Well, we'll continue the chat about Artie's absence, why a lack of central air kept him out of the studio, what Artie missing a day the week before we're off really means, and why everyone seems to assume the worst when Artie doesn't show up for work.
Right.
Plus, Ronnie refused to submit a wedding essay after knowing he was already invited to the wedding. But the real news was JD spotting that Ronnie has been dyeing his mustache and beard.
Did you know that? Ronnie, the limo driver, is now dyeing his mustache and beard. He's using Just for Men.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, you don't dye your hair, do you?
I actually do sometimes.
You do a little bit, right?
Yeah.
I see. It's black, and then but there's some gray on the side.
Yeah, because I do it badly.
You do it yourself? You wouldn't pay someone to do it?
Yeah.
No. Why pay someone to do that?
It's and I'm lazy about it. I mean, most of the time I'm walking around with gray hair sticking out.
You mean you care how you look? This is how you care about... I mean, you really care about... Your hair is very short. You care that it's not gray. You want it black.
Yeah.
You want to look young.
It's still mostly black, but it's still got gray.
And how do you dye it? What product do you use?
Just some crappy product.
Crappy.
Yeah.
What, like Just for Men, or what do you use?
Yeah, just
You don't
some
know the
gray,
name on the bottle?
No, I don't know the name offhand.
Grecian Formula 99?
And I wouldn't say it even if I did, unless they were going to send me free packages.
Do you comb it in?
No. You actually massage it into the hair.
And then what, do you wash it off?
Yeah.
And then the black dye gets all over everything?
Yes.
It must be very embarrassing.
And then for, like, about a week, you do look like Dracula.
Yeah.
Can you believe Gilbert cares?
You look like it's like a cross between Dracula and Jerry Lewis.
This
hair.
Is very yeah. surprising to
yeah.
hear.
I mean, the fact that he cares yeah. enough yes. to make himself look yeah. youthful. Look at you. It's unbelievable. Do you
because
feel...
he certainly didn't care about the rest of him.
No. Do you feel well, sexier?
Well,
with
I
dark
work
hair?
Out, too. You know?
Are your pubes gray? Do you dye those? All right, what else do you have?
Well, we'll see what hard feelings are lingering after that Just for Men conversation. If it was fair to liken Ronnie to a grandpa without the World War II stories, and why does Howard choose to hire staff that could possibly be stalkers and a threat to his life?
He was cheaper than everyone else. I'm like Gilbert. What else do you have?
Plus, Fred gives an E to Harry Franklin's lengthy book, and Howard ends up having to edit Fred. Wedding essays are trickling in, but Sal feels Beth subconsciously controls Howard and is preventing him from attending the wedding. Robin laughs at everyone's wedding song. Wendy the retard is depressed, but $500 richer. Proud, cheap, hair-dyeing father Gilbert Gottfried cites zero comedic influences and laughs at the death of any great comedian. And everything else that happened on today's show, we cover on the wrap-up show.
All right, there he is, John Hine. He knows how to conduct a show. That's been proven. 11 o'clock every day is the wrap-up show. It's a great show. Everybody tune in. Let's get right to Robin and the news. Robin?
Robin, turn around.
You a homo! Oh!
Tommy?
Yes. Hickory dickory dock! Oh!
All right, say something worth listening to her.
Oh!
You fucking dickwad. You stop annoying me. Why don't you come on in here and then we'll talk. You fucking asshole.
Oh, yeah.
Come on, come down here. Don't call me on the phone, you pussy.
What are you, a homo?
Are you?
Yes.
You have the address? Come on down and fuck with me, you little fucker.
In your face.
In your face, fuckface. Come on, come on down here, motherfucker. Come on. Come on, pussy.
Hey, that's the best you can do.
Okay.
Come on down here and say it to my face, you motherfucker.
Okay.
Do it. Get down here. Hurry. Fucking knock your neck loose, motherfucker.
Oh, I love this.
Come on. Bring it on, motherfucker. Bring it on.
Oh, I don't like what you put down!
Dick face. Come on, bring it on.
Yes. Oh, my
don't
muscles
balls,
feel
come down
so
here.
Much
you're
better
now. You're going to call me on the phone and be a dick. Why don't you come down here and try it, dickhead?
Oh, that's right.
Asshole.
Oh, excellent.
Hello.
Hey, Bendy, you want a Bendy on it? Ow!
Fuck is this? Hello?
Hey, Bendy, want to swim around Mike Stingray? Ow!
Well, that's some bullshit, man. Hello?
Well, hello there.
Who the fuck is this?
Paul Winchell.
Well, this motherfucker dripping like a motherfucker. Hello?
Hi, it's Georgie. How's your health been doing, Mama?
Who?
Hey, did you get that parrot I sent you?
Somebody bullshitting on the motherfucking phone. Hello? Hello?
Yes.
Who you want to speak to?
Bendy!
Who you want to speak to?
Yes.
Yes, motherfucker, yes! Who you want to speak to?
Oh! Oh, yeah.
I fuck Desi on his.
Now you're just being silly.
Do I trust you?
Oh, sure.
Oh, yeah, sure, I trust you. I fucked your mom last night.
Holy mackerel! Oh, my goodness. You're an animal. I want to fuck your big droopy yellow tits.
I'm gonna fuck your tits.
No, I can't even get a hard on.
You can't get on hard.
No.
When you got a pussy, you don't get on hard. Are you gay?
Yes.
You are gay?
I have sex with figs.
You have sex with figs?
Yes.
You fucking asshole.
You offended him. All right, now it's time for news.
We've already had a song, Ben.
Oh, come on. We have to reintroduce you. What Gilbert saying?
Well, I get up every morning with a heart on because I'm horny. Grab my Vaseline and then get busy. Then I hear a voice I love. I grab my cock and start to rub. And think I'm Robin with those big round titties. I dream of tickling Robin's clitoris every day. Tickling Robin's clitoris. I'm not gay. Tickling Robin's clitoris. She's real tight.
Gilbert, sing a nice song to Robin.
That is beautiful.
Were you on Hannah Montana? Did you tape an episode of that?
Oh, yeah.
You did?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
And were you a pain in the ass there? That was the story going around.
That was?
Yeah. Were you demanding? What was going on?
What did you hear about that, Andy? Was Gilbert a pain in the ass on Hannah Montana?
Oh, man. A buddy of mine said he knows another guy. I can't say anything, but they said he was a real prick. Demanding this, demanding that.
Well, listen.
He wanted free stuff. He wanted a limo ride.
Is that right? You asked for a free limo?
Hey, Howard, I got to ask you something else, too. I saw Gilbert 3 times in the last 4 years.
Yeah.
I want to know if I, off the air, can he give me a refund back? Because it was the same freaking material.
No, he can't give you a refund. That's impossible.
Howard, they could have just put a DVD up of the same shit from 2 years ago.
Absolutely not. How dare you insult my friend? Well, wow, Hannah Montana, that's a very popular show.
You're getting a new audience from that,
I'm
sure.
Was amazing that I actually got an offer to do a show that people actually watch.
Right. And will you find yourself attracted to that girl? You know, she's only 15.
That makes her more attractive.
Did you do actual scenes with Hannah Montana herself?
No.
Oh, are you working with the dad, Billy Ray Cyrus?
No.
How can you be on Hannah Montana and not see her or Billy Ray Cyrus?
Yes.
I don't understand that.
Yeah, what did you do?
What did you play?
They had me shot like where it was supposed to be they're watching me on TV, where I'm a music critic.
I see. And so you do your thing on your own and then they watch you.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, all right. They didn't want you in the room.
Barney Bittman.
Yeah. Marty Bittman?
Barney.
Barney Bittman.
Barney Bittman.
Right. Okay. So
are you a recurring character?
No. I was just there to critique her concert.
And did you do Sesame Street recently as well?
Yes.
You did.
Yes.
A lot of children's programs.
Yes.
You're popular with kids.
Yes. Yeah.
They love you. And even though you make pedophilia jokes, they don't mind.
Somehow they let it slide.
Yeah. You didn't walk around the set saying, I was in Hannah Montana. And nothing like that.
Yeah, I love going. I was on Hannah Montana, in Hannah Montana.
You like saying
and
that.
And I did Hannah Montana.
You like saying I did Hannah Montana.
Yeah.
I think she's an attractive girl, but she's very,
very
young.
Attractive.
Very young girl.
Yes.
Did you see her at all? That you didn't meet her?
Yeah, I run into them on the set.
I see.
Right. Good for you. All right, listen, it's time for news. Robin, go ahead. Gilbert's here. This should be fun.
And, well, I think this is fascinating. The world's first building in motion is set to be built in Dubai. An Italian architect has announced that he's going to build an 80-story tower with revolving floors that give it an ever-shifting shape.
Wow.
That's pretty incredible.
And I can't believe I'll never see it.
I know, it's in Dubai.
All right, I'm not going there. I would never go to Dubai.
Isn't that fascinating? It'll always give you different views of the Persian Gulf and the skyline of Dubai.
Yeah, oh boy, that's fun.
That's what I've always wanted.
Yeah, yeah, I can't wait because Dubai is so great.
Oh, you're very people friendly.
This time of year, it's lovely.
You never travel, do you?
No.
I don't
like
it.
Do you not go out of the country at all?
I hate traveling.
Me
so
too.
Much.
It's a pain in the ass. And then you go there, and really, it looks the same as here.
And I always kind of feel like, first of all, if you see the Big Ben in a photo,
yeah,
it's even more impressive in a photo.
Yeah, when you see it for real, it's like I traveled all this way to see Big Ben.
Yeah, it's a building with a clock. Yeah. And I always kind of feel like if I went to any country, if you put me in a car and race me and go, okay, this is that palace, that's that building, that's the bridge.
Right.
I could go home after that.
Does your wife want to travel at all?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and you just say no.
Yeah, I hate traveling.
And it won't happen.
Yeah.
You won't even do it for her.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's hope you never have to.
Yes.
All right.
I told you yesterday that Shaquille O'Neal was rapping over the weekend about Kobe Bryant. Here's a little refresher. 2-7.
Yeah, Robin actually has tape of Kobe Bryant rapping, not Kobe Bryant,
no,
Shaquille O'Neal.
No, Shaquille O'Neal rapping about Kobe Bryant.
That's right. All right, what
Who
is this?
Who is the genie in Shazam,
yes.
Right. And he has.
Now stop, think about that. It ain't about that. It's about B.I.G., a.k.a. Big Shaq. Now that's the difference between first and last place. Kobe, tell me how my place. Okay, Kobe.
All right.
So it was, tell me how my ass tastes. Well, you know that Shaq was sort of like an honorary sheriff.
Officer Shaq, yes.
Yes, in Phoenix.
Excuse me, you have to pull over now because I'm Officer Shaq. Imagine the shit you would take in your pants if you saw Shaq get out of a car. The guy's like, what, a 6 foot? He's like a 7 foot black man. Coming up to your car and saying he's Officer Shaq, you would shit your pants.
But why should I pull over, officer? I'm white.
Well,
just pull over right now.
Shaq
actually
taken away his badge.
Oh, because of the words
because
he used?
Because he didn't like the language he used in the rap.
Actually, Shaq's thing was he would go on the internet and pose as a 13-year-old girl and seduce, right? Pedophiles.
That was when he was
so
in
that's
Florida.
Who I was talking
yeah.
to
he was working
all this
in
time.
That division.
Yeah, you spoke to Shaq,
yes,
right? On the internet. You got off on
yeah,
the
yeah, this
charges.
Is quite disappointing.
Hello, Gilbert. This is Natalie. I'm a 13-year-old girl. I'd like to meet you at your hotel.
I don't has no pubic hairs yet. I got smooth 12-year-old skin.
All right. Anything else, Robin?
Yes, the sheriff said he's considered the toughest sheriff in the nation, and he said that Shaq's use of derogatory words in that song helped him come to that decision, quote, saying, I don't condone this type of racial conduct.
Shaq must be destroyed. I mean,
he's being the sheriff and having a badge.
It hasn't been such a good sheriff since Elvis was given a badge by Nixon. Well, let me tell you that is very, very sad.
Yeah, I guess he's sorry now that they even handed him that microphone on Sunday night and got him into all that trouble.
Mr. Godfrey, I want to meet you at a hotel. My 13-year-old vagina is so wet for you. And I love it. And I can't wait to meet you.
Now, I assume you're a little black girl, right?
I heard you said in your last email you look like a Chinese man. And that you can imitate Dracula. That turned me on. Thank you.
Former NBA star Dennis Rodman will be bagging trash instead of baskets after pleading no contest to misdemeanor charges of spousal battery.
You mean if you beat your wife, they just have you pick up garbage?
Well, that's the plea deal
wow.
he worked out. Two other counts were dismissed so, under the deal.
That sounds like a good deal.
Mr. Godfrey, yeah. would you
take
please...
That deal.
Yeah.
Would you pretend you're Dracula and you're raping me?
Rodman...
Oh, you little black bitch.
Oh, thank
I like
you.
Sticking my vampire dick. Into your black pussy.
You're turning my ass on. I can't believe my 13-year-old pussy could be so hot for you.
Oh, I want to stick my undead dick into your 13-year-old black pussy.
Rodman was sentenced to 45 days of road cleanup.
You're quite welcome. You 13-year-old black bitch.
That's 45 days of road cleanup.
Wow.
A year of domestic violence counseling.
I clean up roads just to get to your 13-year-old black pussy.
And 3 years.
I will rise from the dead.
Mr. Godfrey, could you now do Groucho raping me? I'm just a 13-year-old girl who loved Groucho.
I'll just go on. 3 years probation.
But Groucho's about to rape me, Robin.
Okay, sorry about that.
Oh, Groucho, give me your thick cock.
Well, I'm sticking my big dick into your nigger pussy.
Oh, whoa. Yeah, yeah. Why do you have
this
to say
that?
That
wasn't me. That
was you should be on the Imus show.
That was Groucho. 47-year-old Rodman was arrested at a Los Angeles hotel in April.
Well, wait, we can't let that slide.
Yes.
Are you trying to say that Groucho was a racist?
Yes, yes.
Oh, you are? All right, but that's not you saying the N-word.
It's not you me. You would never all say right.
It was and he was senile all at right. the time.
All right, so you're trying to say...
He wasn't racist during his great years.
It's Alzheimer's.
Because I don't like the N-word. I don't like
that. Alzheimer's.
All right. Okay, as long as you explain it, I understand.
Well, he was at a Los Angeles hotel back in April when Peterson reported that he struck her during an altercation.
You're saying if Groucho was senile, he would use the N-word?
Yes, right. Yes.
But you don't know that for a fact.
Goodness, do I dare bring up the BET Awards?
Please do. I'd like to hear that. And really, Gilbert, please. All right, yes, what about the BET Awards, Robin?
Well, they were held last night, and Kanye West is a two-time winner following those awards last night.
Okay.
But he showed his humble side at last night's event when he got the nod for Best Male Hip-Hop Artist. West brought his tough competition, Lil Wayne, on stage to pay his respects. As he accepted his award, he also gave up big props to T-Pain during his acceptance speech for Best Collaboration for their hit, Good Life. But his ego also surfaced as he praised the up-and-coming star, 2-3.
All right. I'm not even sure what you said. So this is Kanye West.
I got a 13-year-old black pussy.
Oh,
you know, a lot of times people try to get real fickle about what they're hearing because the person got a lot of songs on the radio. But we blessed to be in this man's presence. And I'll let y'all know because I'm one of the kings of this game right now. And my opinion counts.
He's always congratulating himself. You know, it's hard for other people to get any props when Kanye West is in the house.
Right.
They say also that Alicia Keys was a big winner last night, Chris Brown, Usher, and Barack Obama's name came up a lot, apparently. So,
are people excited about him on the BET? Are they they're excited because he's a black guy?
Well, the host was D.L. Hughley, and he touched on topics from R. Kelly to Barack Obama during the night's show.
Obama!
Is Obama a Mac Daddy? I believe so.
What?
Daddy!
What?
Obama is a long-legged Mac Daddy!
I see!
Obama pimps white women and black women!
Notice
Obama!
That.
That's where you first saw his name! That's the first place I saw it on two great big old tits!
Please, Gilbert, no more Groucho raping a 13-year-old girl. Right, please, it didn't go over well.
Some of the other awards. Best actor went to Denzel Washington.
Okay.
Best actress to Halle Berry.
Fair enough.
Best male athlete of the year, Kobe Bryant.
If Halle Berry was 12 years old.
All right, come on. Come on, Groucho. Yes. See now, Groucho. Really, I don't approve of that. All right, what else, Robin?
Let me see. And a Lifetime Achievement Award was given to Al Green.
Any white people win at the BET Awards?
Never.
Or never. There's no talented white people.
Not at all.
Well, Halle Berry's pretty white. She's almost white.
Yeah.
That's a white award.
I don't know why you wouldn't say that Tiger Woods is the athlete of the year.
He's white.
I like how Halle Berry tries to be the poor black woman who made it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. She's not black. Do you think Barack Obama's black?
No.
No.
Obama!
Anything else?
Does Gilbert vote?
No.
No.
Do you vote?
No.
Seriously, you don't?
I haven't for a while.
Really?
When was the last time?
I'm a bad American.
Did you vote at one point?
I don't know.
Did you ever vote?
Maybe once.
who did you vote for that you were that passionate?
Yeah, like
Hitler,
who brought you out?
Think, yeah.
Who?
Hitler.
Hitler.
Yes.
No,
so,
no, come on. Who did you vote for?
I had
for?
Bad feelings after that election.
You one time voted.
Yeah.
Well, who was it that moved you to vote?
I don't remember.
You really don't?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that true?
I think I voted for the sake of voting.
You felt guilty
yes.
about
not. Yeah.
But that you got over it and you haven't done it since.
But, Gilbert, why not? I mean, you care about the direction of the country, don't you?
Yes.
Do you care about the Iraq war?
Oh, yeah.
You do?
Yes.
You do care
do
about
you
it.
Know we're at war?
Yes. I mean, still don't know exactly why.
Do you get angry about stuff like that?
Yeah, confused.
Confused. All right, yeah, so why not look into it and vote and try to...
Try to make a difference.
Right.
Okay, I'll do it.
All right, there you go.
All right.
You participated in the writer's strike, right?
So
you cared about that.
Yes.
Right. That affected your money.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Okay. All right. There you go.
You know, one of the worst things is to be food for an animal, I suppose.
I know. That's the worst death. I know what you're referring to.
Well, authorities say a New Mexico man was killed and partially eaten by a mountain lion.
And even buried... Oh, come on. He even buried parts of the guy.
The New Mexico Department of Game and Fish say they found the 55-year-old's body near his mobile home after his brother reported the man missing last week. A department spokesperson said the victim was most likely killed by the mountain lion or a cougar close to his home, where he was known to bathe outdoors.
Right.
The animal apparently dragged the man's body into a nearby wooded area to eat and bury parts of the body. Oh, stop it. The search crew said it found and shot a mountain lion near the victim's home. When the lion took off, an officer found the door of the man's mobile home open with the water running.
Right.
So he got him out of the shower.
All right. Adam, go ahead. You're on the air.
Hello. Howard.
Hello, hello.
Hey. Howard, hey, I wanted to tell you about that Alanis Morissette. You know, you said that she mispronounced the word.
Well, it's poetic license.
Well, no, I think she's actually quoting a French philosopher who uses the word différence it's kind of a clever play on words. And,
okay, so she's intentionally.
Yeah, she's being, you know, she's being high-minded.
She's being intellectual.
She's being very intellectual. It means to not only to differ, but also to defer.
Difference.
All
right, got it. All right, thank you.
I see. She's going for a lot there.
Well, can you open up the contest, the letter writing contest, to listeners?
You know, I'll tell you the truth. My wedding is not going to be a bit. I'm not going. You know, I'm getting married, Gilbert. I don't know if you're aware.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you're not invited, so don't worry.
Oh, okay.
All right. You don't want to go.
I thought you said it was going to be star-studded. No, Gilbert?
Well, exactly.
I said it is not going to be star-studded. That people expect me to know a lot of stars. I don't know. Did you have stars at your wedding?
No.
No. I mean, as famous as you are, you didn't have any.
I don't know any famous people.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't really have a long laundry list of friends who are famous. So, I mean, people expect they're going to come to my wedding and see famous people. It's not going to be like that. It's going to be a couple. It's going to be a dinner for some friends, and I'm doing a thing for my family. So it's that's it.
Yeah,
you understand. Small, understated.
Yes.
You didn't have a big wedding, did you?
No. Of all people
no.
will understand.
You would have had to pay for a big wedding.
Yeah.
And the fact of the matter is, I don't know what people are expecting. And then really to start opening it up to the listeners with a contest, it would make a total mockery of this marriage. Seriously. All right, Adam?
Yeah, I hear you.
All right, thank you.
All right.
I'm sorry to piss you off.
He really wanted to go.
Yeah.
Apparently.
All right.
Well, there was also an alligator attack on a boy who was swimming down, I guess, in Florida.
Although I am considering a song parody contest.
To get in?
Yeah. It's a little more work.
Here's the young man himself who says, his name is Casey Edwards. He says he fought like crazy to survive the alligator attack. 1-4.
Just like hold on with everything I could from the skater trying to pull me under, and I'd surface, get a gasp of air, and he'd just shake again and pull me under, and he did it about 5 times.
Wow.
He credits his friends with getting him out of it, and I guess the gator got his arm, you know.
The guy has no arm.
I think he lost an arm to the gator.
Boy, he sounds so, you know, like, oh, no big deal.
Well, you know, still in shock.
Probably
doesn't even realize what happened.
Right.
He's just happy to be alive.
Wow.
So.
Why was he around an alligator? Where was he?
He was in Florida swimming. You know, it was like maybe the alligator
creeks?
Got
swimming
into
one of those canals.
Some place that he wasn't necessarily supposed to be. Yeah, it was in a canal.
I would never swim in a canal. Never. Someone told me
there were
alligators.
Well, not in Florida, maybe.
You're not kidding. Especially where there's alligators. Who would take that chance? What am I, Tarzan?
I'm amazed, too, how calm he was about that.
Right.
It's like, yeah.
I'd be like,
yeah. If I got, like, one scratch from right. it that I kept, I would be...
I'm okay, just lost my arm, but I got another one.
Yeah.
Anything else, Robin?
The wife of CNN personality Larry King has entered rehab, according to the New York Post, page 6.
Can you blame her?
48-year-old Sean Southwick King is now in treatment for an addiction to painkillers.
I'd be in pain, too, if Larry was climbing on top of me.
They say that Sean is in rehab for medication issues related to her chronic migraine problem.
Why would my wife have a migraine problem?
She's had that headache for 10 years.
Why do you keep holding your head, honey? What's the matter? Why do you get a headache around me?
Your sexy husband's home from work. Let's go.
74-year-old Larry and Sean, his sixth wife, have been married for 10 years and have two young children together.
Well, I'll give it to Larry, though. He's held on to this marriage. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but look at her. She's really suffering from it.
Yeah. It's killing her. Lovely lady.
Come on, let's have sex. Detroit, you're on the air.
So, there you go, Sean, trying to take care of that painkiller problem.
All right.
We announced earlier in the week that Amy Winehouse's father says that she is suffering from the beginning stages of emphysema from smoking cigarettes and crack.
She's 23, and she's got emphysema already.
But she looks so healthy.
Yeah, at least she looks good.
And now people are watching her every move. She was spotted smoking a cigarette yesterday following her release from the hospital. So they say in spite of this dire diagnosis, she's still risking her lung health by smoking cigarettes.
I can't believe that. She seems so well thought out. You know, what a shame when you're given a gift with that kind of voice. I mean, she has a beautiful voice and a great singing style, and it's as if she pisses on it. If I could sing like that, I wouldn't do any. I would just watch my throat. I would do that. Would be my moneymaker. If I could, I wish I could sing.
She doesn't seem to care.
I'm a great singer.
You sing very good Jewish songs. Yes. You're terrific. You talented that way.
Yeah. And you take care of your voice.
It would be terrible if I started smoking.
Right. Did you ever consider becoming a cantor at a temple? Sounds like somebody in your childhood made you go to temple every weekend.
Winehouse was reportedly caught puffing in between rehearsals for two upcoming performances. Despite the cigarette break, concert organizers for Nelson Mandela's birthday bash, where Winehouse is scheduled to perform this Friday, say her rehearsals went well.
Oh, yeah. If she shows up, it goes well.
Well, the rehearsal went well. We'll have to see what happens with the performance itself. Gilbert's ready to step in if she is unavailable.
Right.
Italian businessman and ex-boyfriend of actress Anne Hathaway faces federal charges for allegedly setting up a real estate company to scheme the Catholic Church out of hundreds of thousands of dollars.
It sure pisses me off when a guy like that gets a hot piece of ass like Anne Hathaway. Like, you know, what about good guys like me and Gilbert?
Federal prosecutors and are leveling wire fraud and conspiracy charges.
And I love the fact he's not only rich, but like real Euro trash.
Yeah, she fell for him hard. I told you, I went to a movie premiere. She was the star, and she was there with him, and she was running around and crying and having all kinds of wild scene with this guy. And he'd run off, and she'd run off.
He was even giving her a hard time.
No, it was wild. Boy, was she in love. But, of course, look what happened.
Raffaello Folieri was
My
claiming
name is
to have...
Raffaello. I would like to date you, Anne Hathaway.
Folieri.
I would like to date Anne Hathaway. Come here and throw my Italian penis.
You are from Italy and you are a wealthy financier.
I am a very big financier.
And you like Anne Hathaway.
I like Anne Hathaway's big ass. Take your big ass over here, and I will cheat companies out of billions of dollars for you.
Well,
he claimed to have close ties to the Vatican and many
I know the Pope personally.
Property.
Fuck me, Ed. I know the Pope.
He used the money from these real estate deals to bankroll an elaborate New York lifestyle, which included a Trump Tower apartment overlooking Rockefeller Center in Central Park at $37,000 a month.
See, a guy like that, he's a bright guy. He just can't play it straight. That's his problem.
He's being held on $21 million bail.
These con artists, they're all geniuses, you know, but they can't. There's a gene inside of them, I think, that just doesn't allow them to earn an honest living. They've got to swindle somebody out of something, you know. What is that, a cake made out of Jews you brought in? Is that what you brought her for your first date, Raphael?
Ash, it was made from the ashes that I collected in Auschwitz. And I made a delicious cake.
A delicious Jew cake.
A delicious Jew cake from the ashes in Auschwitz. Vidatan. Trablinka topping.
Thank you. Anything else, Robin, in the news?
Yes, presidential candidate Barack Obama got the, quote, Hollywood treatment last night at a celebrity-studded fundraiser for his campaign and the Democratic National Committee. Many celebrities who had supported Hillary Clinton are now rallying behind Barack Obama. Clinton's top fundraisers are also being wooed by Obama in hopes of adding to the nearly $290 million Obama has already raised. Here's California Attorney General Jerry Brown, who was at the event, 2-5.
All right. This is Jerry Brown speaking about Obama.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I'd like to hear that. Here we go, Gilbert. I know you're anxious.
I saw a lot of key Hillary people there, and when he walked in, the enthusiasm, the applause, it was real. It was genuine. This man is a unifier.
All right.
So they say he's bringing the party together. The guest list included Samuel L. Jackson, Sugar Ray Leonard, and singer Seal, who performed.
Seal, yes. He's with Heidi Klum. Yes. Yes. All right. Robin?
And the Clintons seem to be throwing their support behind Barack Obama.
Yeah, Seal, I heard him in the background.
Hillary Clinton has returned to Capitol Hill for the first time since suspending her presidential campaign. She told reporters that her goal is to be the very best senator she can be, and Clinton said she's no longer seeking the vice presidential nod from Illinois Senator Barack Obama, the presumptive Democratic presidential nominee, and she is also urging her supporters to get behind him. 2-6.
Anyone who voted for me has very little in common with the Republican Party. If you care about the issues I care about and the future that I outlined during my campaign, then you really have to stay with us in the Democratic Party and vote for Senator Obama to be our next president.
I think secretly she'd like to see McCain win. I do.
No, I do.
I agree.
She cares about the country more than that, Howard.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I love Hillary. I wish Hillary was the nominee, the presumptive nominee. But she is not, and I was for her. I like her.
Well, listen to what she's saying.
Yeah, I don't believe it.
Oh, you think you're reading between the lines.
Yeah.
She's saying vote McCain, vote McCain.
She's saying vote McCain, and then we can, you know.
4 years from now, I'll run again.
Right. McCain and a game. All right, any other?
Bill Clinton's former Secretary of State says changes need to come in fighting terrorism as well. Madeleine Albright adds the idea of presumptive Democratic presidential nominee Barack Obama meeting with enemy regimes should not be disregarded. To
the allegations that have to be stopped is to say that just talking to the Iranians is wrong. You have to talk to your enemies, not just your friends.
There's no talking to the Iranians, trust me.
She also praised Obama's ideas on fighting terrorism.
A President Obama will have a very robust approach in terms of...
The Iranians are irrational. It would be like talking to, you know, Hitler. I mean, there's no talking. They're irrational.
You
they
haven't
hate...
had one conversation with
I remember
an Iranian.
Ronald Reagan's approach to the Iranians. It worked best. They understand
We're
one thing.
We're still fighting with them. That's the result.
If he was still president, the war would have been over.
Sure, sure, sure.
That's it. There would have been no terrorism.
He would have been sitting there going...
No, come on. Now you're being disrespectful.
He had Alzheimer's.
Come on. I'm not going to stand here for that. I'm not going to do that. Anything else, Robin?
Iran's Revolutionary Guard is warning the United States it will face a tragedy if it attacks the Islamic Republic.
Well, we have the Morian Guard.
In a statement today, a senior commander of the elite guard said, quote, we advise U.S. officials to be careful not to face another tragedy.
No, we're shaking in our boots.
The warning comes amid stock market rumors of a possible Israeli military strike against Iran's nuclear sites. So there you go. They're saying they're going to take that as an attack against them by the U.S.
All right. Anything else, or is that it?
One of John McCain's top advisors has apologized for his remarks that a September 11th type attack before the November election would benefit McCain.
Right.
Charlie Black called the comment inappropriate and expressed deep regret. Former presidential candidate Mitt Romney says, quote, it's an unthinkable scenario. 2-4.
All right. Unthinkable it is. 2-4?
2-4.
All right. This is Charlie Black.
That's what I said.
But I don't think people...
You said Mitt Romney.
I did say Mitt Romney. It sounds like Mitt Romney.
People who are running for office want to be characterized by that kind of punditry, if you will. Instead, they want to be characterized by their positions on issues.
So, yes, they're saying... And some people are calling for McCain to fire this guy for making such a statement. But
you're going to see Gilbert July 10th at 8 o'clock at Caroline's on Broadway in Manhattan?
I would love to.
Well, okay. Then go to carolines.com for information. That's what he's here for. And he's got that Fakakta DVD, Dirty Jokes. Go to GilbertGottfried.com.
They're saying that they've come up with the first vaccine to treat lung cancer in Cuba.
Wow, how's that possible? We have great medical facilities, top doctors, and Cuba's come up with a lung cancer treatment?
Yes.
I don't believe it. I'm sure it's not for real.
Scientists say they have a drug that has been shown to significantly improve the survival rates among patients. Unlike traditional chemotherapy treatments for lung cancer, the drug has few side effects and delivers a modified protein which attacks cancer cells.
All right. I'll believe it when I see it.
They say it's the first vaccine for lung cancer registered in the world. The Cubans coming on in medical research.
Wow.
That's amazing.
Anything else?
Golf superstar Tiger Woods has successfully undergone surgery on his left knee. The procedure was performed in Park City, Utah, and came 8 days after Woods captured the third U.S. Open title. No timetable has been given for his recovery. They expect he will miss the season's final two major championships and the Ryder Cup while recovering. That's a big blow to golf because Tiger Woods brings in so many viewers.
There was nothing wrong with his knee.
He had a broken leg.
I don't believe it.
He was playing, and he won the U.S.
And he won,
Open.
And that should officially not be a sport. He can win the U.S. Open with a broken leg. He's hardly an athlete. I never heard of that. That's insane. What else, Robin?
The Taliban doing very well. They made $100 million last year from Afghan farmers growing poppies for the opium trade.
Well, that's what it's all about.
That's what we're fighting. They can raise $100 million to fund, you know, the rebuilding of an army.
Right. They have so much money in the heroin trafficking. That's
it's
why so they...
crazy.
That's I think we should go there and talk to them.
Yes. No, I think good people idea. Should stop taking drugs in this country. You know we're the biggest market.
Well, talking...
If you care about the troops...
That's why talking sounds so reasonable.
I'm sure if we sat down with the Taliban...
They will listen.
Yeah.
Right.
No, I'm telling
Iranians
you...
Iranians, too.
All yes. those people with those little ribbons on there, stop taking drugs.
The Iranians don't want to wipe us off the planet and...
No, no.
See
they,
an all-Muslim world?
It's a misunderstanding.
Right. I'm
oh,
sure,
the two of you are yeah. so bright.
So once a Barack sits down at the table with them, everything will be cool.
Sure,
I think once he says, like, look, it's a Obama! Misunderstanding... We feel this Look. Way, you feel this way.
Let's, and you're saying they won't build any nuclear power plants and have the
no,
atom bomb?
No, you say, hey, let's have a compromise, fellas.
All right.
Look, he got white people to vote for him. He obviously is a persuasive guy.
Well, he truly is. Robin, is there anything else?
But white people are rational.
Really? Which ones
kidding.
Have you met?
What are you talking about?
All right, go ahead. Not on this
a
show.
A health expert says the health of poor Americans... are being devastated, what is being devastated, by worms and parasites.
I believe that.
Such diseases as dengue fever.
You know, I had pinworms.
And Chagas disease may become a bigger issue in the U.S. as the climate changes.
I got some dengue fever.
I'm itchy. Anything else, Robin?
The expert says this disease and others keep people locked into poverty because the effects can last years, decades, or even lifetimes.
I'll tell you what. Eat cake without parasites. That's the answer.
He says the diseases occur predominantly in, quote, people of color living in the Mississippi Delta and elsewhere in the American South and disadvantaged urban areas. The findings can be found in his report for the journal Public Library of Science Neglected Tropical Diseases.
Right.
Oh, stop that.
Well, he has dengue fever.
Oh, my goodness.
Gilbert. It's very wet back there. Try up that area, Gilbert. You can fight it.
Oh, that sounds fight terrible.
It.
You
fight
really
it.
Ought to get
hold
that.
It in.
Look at.
Hold it in.
Ah, oh, I'm trying. Oh, oh, ah, damn. Oh,
is that the
oh.
same acting you used on Hannah Montana?
Yes.
Robin, is that what's happening?
I was telling you about the Taliban raising so much money. Here's Major General Jeffrey Schlosser, who says you can expect more Taliban attacks in Afghanistan.
Frankly, this number was not unexpected. You know, there's been an increase ever since 2002 each year, and we came here fully expecting that there would be an increase this year.
All right.
Yeah, they're having a good time over there with the money they're raising from drugs, and now they're regrouping and attacking American troops. Yeah. Barbara Walters and The View, I guess they moved the show to Las Vegas this week.
Isn't that great?
And here's Barbara telling us there's so many reasons to love Las Vegas.
We love everything about it. We love our audiences. We love the great stars that come here.
Yeah, there's tons of hookers.
Some of the ladies love to gamble. Sometimes they win. And I spent a lot of time here when I was growing up because my father brought the Follies Bergère to a hotel at the time called the Tropicana. So I'm very familiar with Las Vegas.
And the showgirls here all have dengue fever.
We are still paying tribute to George Carlin days after his death.
Not Gilbert.
Yeah.
He refuses.
Some people
who gives a shit, who gives a fuck?
That he was the first guest host of Saturday Night Live so many years ago.
That's true.
Here's a clip.
Ladies and gentlemen, George Carlin!
And here's a little bit of his opening monologue.
Talking about a live show. Well, nice to see you. Welcome, and thanks for joining us live. I'm kind of glad that we're on at night so that we're not competing with all the football and baseball games. So many, man. All the time. And this is the time of year when there's both, you know? Football's kind of nice. They changed it a little bit. They moved the hash marks in. Guys found them and smoked them anyway.
All right.
Wanted.
Look at Gilbert writing that down.
George can't use it anymore.
All right.
Wanted is coming to a theater near you soon. It stars James McAvoy and Angelina Jolie. Here's James to talk about Angelina.
Angelina Jolie comes along and tells him that he has actually got a father. And he's had one this entire time. And he's
all right, this guy, I don't understand what he's mumbling about.
Get Smart Steve Carell, number one movie at the box office this weekend. Here he jokes about his co-star, Anne Hathaway.
I might have initially said that Anne Hathaway would not be hot enough to share the screen with me, that in watching the movie, it might be sort of evident and that all eyes would...
Okay.
Have you seen some of the promotion they're doing for this film together?
I haven't.
Where they try to be off-the-cuff funny with each other.
No, I hate that. I hate those interviews. I hate it all.
Yeah.
And I love the original Get Smart. That was the best. I choose to remember that. I'm officially an old fart.
You don't want to see this new thing.
I don't want to see it.
No, me neither.
You either. But you don't get out of the house.
Yeah. But
with another
reason. Yeah, no, I love the old Get Smart.
Of course. It was a classic. Yeah. It's enough. All you can't remake that. How could that be better?
And I don't think they have Jaime.
No.
What's his name?
Right, Jaime. Jaime the robot.
What was that actor's name?
Dick
Gaudier.
Dick Gaudier. Yes. Yeah. Listen, they tried to remake the Munsters. You remember? They even had some of the original cast.
Horrible.
17 years later, it was horrible.
Do you remember they had two Hermans.
Yes, yes.
Okay, who are the two Hermans?
Well, Fred Gwynn.
No, I mean, that was the original.
Right.
The two synths.
One was that little fat guy.
Little fat guy?
He's a chubby guy.
Yeah.
Can't think of his name.
John Shuck.
That's it.
John
Shuck. Who was
Shuck.
The second one?
This is amazing. The other one was Edward Herman.
I don't remember. I never saw that.
Yeah. He always plays those intellectual parts.
Wow.
Yeah, he's played Roosevelt, hasn't
yeah.
he? Yeah.
And I think Bobby Moss was Grandpa in one of them.
Oh, yes. You're right.
Yeah.
That's with the space between his teeth.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else, Robin?
Britney Spears has gotten overnight visits with her kids put back on the...
Good.
Plate for her.
Now she's, I can relax.
Yes, I know you were all upset that she had lost custody of the kids and K-Fed was raising them and she could only have supervised visits. Well, now the kids can stay overnight with their mom.
By the way, Saturday Night Live is rerunning the episode of the original episode with George Carlin this Saturday night as a tribute to George Carlin.
Isn't that wonderful?
That's right.
And didn't he just go into rehab like George Carlin?
I don't know that.
Not too long ago. Yeah,
like about a month before he died, he went into rehab.
Oh, see that? Who knows? Maybe he was really abusing himself.
See, so maybe you shouldn't go into rehab.
Right. Look at Amy Winehouse.
Look at what happened to poor George.
Anything else, Robin?
The drugs. I think for today...
You are done? Well,
that's
Gilbert,
what's happening.
Gilbert reminds you to go see him July 10th at 8 p.m. at Caroline's on Broadway in Manhattan. And, of course, you'll see him doing all of his impressions, his comedy, and his new Groucho appearance today was fantastic. Except for when he got racist. That's all right.
Well, it was very accurate, though.
Well, you do a good impression.
An accurate depiction of Groucho?
Well, no.
As a racist, senile old man.
When people go senile, they become very racist.
Right. To purchase Gilbert's comedy DVD, Dirty Jokes, go to GilbertGottfried.com. Good luck to you with all of your jokes.
Go home and tell your daughter.
Yes.
That routine.